In the biblical account, we learn that Joseph appointed men throughout the land of Egypt to oversee the gathering and storing of the grain in all the cities during the 7 years of plenty. Later, during the famine, he gave the orders for the distribution of the grain. And the famine was over all the face of the earth, and Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold unto the Egyptians. But when foreigners came to purchase grain, they went to Joseph, the governor. When Joseph's brothers came to Egypt to buy grain, they would eventually find themselves bowing to Joseph. We believe it is Saqqara to which they came, where the remains of this fantastic complex are preserved, and it was here that Pharaoh Zoser had 11 extremely large pits constructed, which can only be grain storage bins. Every city had stored grain from its region, but at this complex at Saqqara we have these massive pits which would have stored an incredible amount of grain, more than a single city would ever have needed. And at the entrance to the complex, as we described earlier, there are 40 small cubicles, each just the right size to hold a single person who could administer the receipt of payment from people coming to purchase the grain. They would then have received their bags of grain. The design of the pits is impressive. There are 11 of them, with only one containing a very elaborate stairway extending all the way to the bottom. All the pits are connected to each other by a subterranean tunnel. The pits were filled and the tops were sealed with wooden timbers and stone, and all of the grain could be accessed from one entrance, and there is one entrance into the pits from outside the wall enclosure of the complex. And did you know, grain was found in the floor of these pits. The complex at Saqqara is unique. Nothing like it has ever been found. A great deal has been written about this complex, and most mention the uniqueness of it, something they cannot explain. I suggest to you that the circumstantial evidence fits the story of Joseph perfectly. We know from the biblical account that Joseph died in Egypt and was embalmed and placed in a coffin. It says, "So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt." In a coffin in Egypt. But when the children of Israel left Egypt some two centuries later, at the time of the Exodus, Joseph's bones were taken with them. And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, for he, Joseph, had straitly sworn to the children of Israel, saying, "God will surely visit you, and ye shall carry up my bones away hence with you." One of the big mysteries for Egyptologists has been the tomb of Im-hotep. They simply cannot find it, although they know it should be somewhere in Saqqara. In the guidebook to Saqqara by Jill Camel, the tomb of Im-hotep is listed as a subject heading, only to explain that it has not been found. Now, suppose that Im-hotep was Joseph. And if Joseph's body was taken away, could it be that his tomb was possibly taken over and used by someone else? And would this not wipe out the original identity of the tomb from being that of Im-hotep?
Yep.
Ancient Greek texts spoke of a place near Memphis where people came to worship Im-hotep and be healed. Excavators at Saqqara, working very near the Step Pyramid, have found an incredible labyrinth of underground tunnels. These were full of mummified ibis and bulls. Over the centuries, great waves of sand had swept in from the Sahara Desert and completely covered the area, until in 1850 French archaeologist Mariette discovered the place where the sacred bulls were buried. The wind blowing over the shifting sand had exposed a small opening. The bulls were in coffins of solid granite, polished as smooth as glass. Their average weight is 150 tons. The Egyptians, of course, were pagans who worshipped many different animals as gods. Inscriptions and coins found here show that people came here to be healed. What had just been found then was the famous sanctuary to Im-hotep, written by the Greeks. After the deification of Im-hotep by the Egyptians as god of medicine, he was given the title Chief One of the Ibis. And this was the connection of this labyrinth with Im-hotep. The hundreds of thousands of ibis that were mummified and brought here were a tribute to none other than Im-hotep filling these tunnels. These galleries, it was later found, were connected to a pit. And the pit extended down to a funerary chamber which contained an empty coffin. The chamber belonged to a large mastaba tomb. And in the tomb's storerooms were jars whose clay stoppers had the seal impression of Pharaoh Zosa. Well, here is absolute proof that this was the tomb of a very important person of Zosa's reign. No inscriptions were found on the walls and the sarcophagus was empty. But even more importantly, this mastaba is orientated to the north instead of to the east as the other pyramids are. This was an important tomb of someone from Zosa's time, but the sarcophagus was empty. And it had titles applicable to Joseph on it. There was even found an inscription by an anonymous Greek who came here telling how he was cured, and it was through a dream. Once again, the evidence speaks loudly of a wonderful story from the Bible, the story of Joseph. The Pyramid of Ptah, first king of Dynasty 6, is called by the local populace the Prison Pyramid. Local tradition says that it was built near the ruins of the prison where Joseph was confined. The pyramid is located near Saqqara, in a likely area for such imprisonment. Joseph the dreamer saved Egypt by a prophecy which he claimed was from God. That prophecy was very specific. Did you know the Bible contains some 1,000 prophecies, some concerning Egypt, which reach thousands of years into the future, even to our day? Of course, we humans can be sure of nothing, even seconds ahead, isn't that right? Just ask any horse punter. You may have heard of the wealthy King Croesus, who went to visit the Oracle of Delphi. He wanted to know whether he should fight the Persians. The wise Oracle told him that, by crossing the river Halys, Croesus will destroy a mighty power. Well, Croesus took this as a prophecy that he would destroy the great Persian army. So he went into battle, but he was defeated. Yes, he did destroy a mighty power, his own. Whichever way the battle went, the augury would be true. Human prophecy, I've found, is much like that.